Amongst the vast categories of fiction, the Warhammer franchise has become one of the most appreciated and beloved of grimdark fantasy and sci-fi, the most recognisable segment being the 40k universe, whose characters, lore, and memes have helped keep its relevance for decades, so of course, video games would spring forth. While strategy games and first-person shooters have been the norm, a few third-person action games like 2011's Space Marine by Relic Entertainment have left a cult impact through its violent brawling combat, solid presentation of the setting and story, and just enough fan service to keep players going. It's only a shame that the planned trilogy never materialized that would have remedied the handful of bumps keeping away from greatness. The Forge World of Goriah, where the massive Titan war machines are built, is under attack from a horde of orcs that are quickly overrunning the planet's defenses. With military assets in jeopardy, a relief force is dispatched with a squad of ultramarines leading the vanguard. As Captain Titus, you cleave through the green mass with Blade and Bolter, assisting the beleaguered Imperial Guard and securing the Titans. Things go astray when an Inquisitor enlists your help in securing a possibly demonic and unstable energy source in order to power a Doomsday weapon, something which Titus has an apparent resistance against. As franchise veterans, Relic does a great job of capturing the apocalyptic conditions of the 40k universe, as is only constant war and struggle. While not having the crispest textures, the colossal scale of the structures and the mighty battles underway are awe-inspiring. Having swarms of enemies assault the player without the engine breaking a sweat is still impressive. Instead of being a nihilistic story, which is the norm in 40k, there's a lot of character and humanity on display through the collectible audio logs of unfortunate survivors and the guardsmen struggling to hold on, as well as a handful of main characters. The story has its predictable twists and turns, yet the large set pieces and great performance by Mark Strong as Captain Titus sells the average writing. He cares about his troops as well as respects his allies, making him wholly likable. Space Marine on the Surface is a very linear third-person title, rarely deviating from killing and smashing monsters over its 6-7 hour long campaign. You move from one room to the next, finding an arena to press a button or just move on. However, it's the simplicity and satisfying combat that makes the game so playable. For a long time, most third-person games were heavily influenced by Gears of War's successful cover-based shooting mechanics, which have barely changed. No such thing exists in Space Marine. Enemies will relentlessly charge towards you, leading to intense space-age brawling. There's three melee weapons on offer, a fast-slashing chainsword, a hard-hitting axe, and the crushing thunderhammer. Each have different combos and finishing moves, and swapping them out is encouraged. You're also equipped with four different firearms, a standard pistol, a rapid-firing bolter, and two other specialized weapons, ranging from long-range rifles, heavy machine guns, and grenade launchers. The controls and melee combo system is straightforward, but the heavy weight behind each slash, charge, and explosive munition leaves a devastating impact. Enemies are blown apart or gibbed entirely, and body parts scatter the environment and scream. Very cathartic. Your health is managed through a regenerative shield and a health bar that's replenished by killing stunned or weakened enemies. These finishes are like the icing on the cake for every fight. This and the lack of a cover system pushes a very aggressive playstyle instead of taking pot shots and hiding for a minute. After enough carnage, you can enter a fury mode, allowing you to cleave through swarms of opponents. This can be upgraded a couple of times across the game and becomes a useful crutch to fall back on. There's an occasional set-piece moment or vehicular stage to spice things up, like defending an air assault, or better yet, acquiring some jump jets and smashing into crowds of bad guys. These are some of the best parts of the game, with a mixture of vertical combat and movement. The obvious problem of having ceaseless combat is it becoming repetitive and stale, yet it still avoids this via good art direction, sound effects, and weapons like the melter gun that vaporizes enemies. Well, until the second half, because, spoiler alert, for a nearly decade-old game, chaos gets involved and things get fucked up real fast. Demons and corrupt space marines are hefty bullet sponges against even high-end weapons, and lots of hit-scanning enemies are thrown at you, making melee combat much harder. It starts exposing the clunkiness of attacking as you'll miss targets or get locked into animations before getting blown away. It's safer, while it's unsatisfying, to stand back with a long-range weapon and pick them off. There's still good combat to be had as the stakes start mounting, and a fair bit of Blood Raven fan service, but the reduced score, inability to combo through enemies, drags down the last few hours with many retries. Space Marine is at its best when fulfilling that power fantasy drive, not getting caught in level geometry. There's disappointingly no cooperative campaign, and the multiplayer is mostly dead, so that just leaves a single player. At a good price, it's well worth it as it's one of the best 40k games out there for both veterans and newcomers alike. If you want warfare and gore as a holy warrior, this will probably fulfill that niche. Otherwise, he's hoping for Relic to make a sequel or another team to take up the task of refining this obscure gem.